I'm always challenged by technology, frankly.
Well, I would agree with you. I have many challenges myself.
Well, supposedly we're live, right, Seth?
I'm ready when you are.
Okay, so we're live on Doc Talk Live on Facebook, and I want to thank Dr. Oliver Sartor, who's pulled over in his car this afternoon to talk to us about prostate cancer. Is that right, Oliver?
That's right. It's a great topic.
So what is your, are you urology, oncology? What is your background?
No, I'm a medical oncologist, trained in internal medicine, did medical oncology fellowship up at the National Cancer Institute, and then started to focus on prostate cancer in about 1990. And sort of strangely, I enjoyed it and stuck with it for the last 30 years.
That's great. And you're at Tulane University, right?
Right. I'm at Tulane Medical School, and I've been there for 12 years now. I'm a Tulane Medical School graduate many moons ago, but came back to Tulane and joined the faculty 12 years ago.
So prostate cancer can be an incredibly broad topic, and we only have about 10 or 15 minutes to discuss it. So where should we go? What main points would you like our listeners to hear about prostate cancer?
Well, you know, I think there are a couple of points. Number one is I'd like to cover a little bit about screening, a little bit about active surveillance. I'd like to cover a little bit about the genetics that we're learning a lot about, and then perhaps a tad bit on some of the advances that we've had more recently, which are particularly applicable for those patients who have advanced disease, metastatic disease. So, you know, I can take those components, kind of divide it up, and each one of them has some interesting points.
Okay. Well, let's start with screening. For instance, I'm 56. Okay. My understanding, medically speaking, is if I live long enough, I'm going to get prostate cancer.
And I think that's accurate, you know, and so screening has both pros and cons, but one of the things that I think is different today is we understand better about risk stratification. And we don't always have to biopsy everybody with an elevated PSA. There's good work published in the New England Journal where we can use a MRI and a very fancy MRI, multiparametric MRI, to serve as a screen after the elevation in PSA comes around to determine who gets a biopsy and who doesn't. Additional risk stratification makes a big difference because now we're not diagnosing all those low-risk patients that previously we were diagnosing and then recommending active surveillance for.
How do you find that MRI?
Well, there are specialized centers that run it, and it's not any MRI. It really has to be somebody focusing in on prostate. It needs to be a multiparametric machine, be able to look at diffusion weighting and some other parameters. And it needs to be read by somebody who knows what they're doing. And, you know, fortunately at Tulane, we do have that skill set, but a lot of the community hospitals right now are not very well set up, and people order an MRI, but they don't get a good read because it's not properly done in the software and not properly read by the folks who need to read it.
Okay, so let's move on to active surveillance. How do we go from screening to active surveillance? What does that mean?
Well, when we diagnose prostate cancer, we have various ways of putting people into different risk categories. And the simplest is, you know, low, intermediate, and high. And the high-risk guys have a high Gleason, like Gleason 8 to 10, or a PSA greater than 20, or extracapsular extension on the on their exam. And those guys all need treatment. I mean, that's no controversy in that. But the low-risk patients, and those are patients with a Gleason score of 6, PSA less than 10, and typically no findings on the digital rectal, what we call stage T1C, those guys, we really are better off watching and putting them under surveillance rather than treating them and getting the side effects of treatment.
So is surveillance, once again, PSA and MRI?
We use the PSA, the MRI, and we also use the exam. And use what we typically do is PSA about every 3 to 6 months. We do an exam about every 6 months and talk to the patient. And then we get an MRI once a year. And that actually works in our hands quite well. We have literally hundreds of patients under surveillance, and I think we've done a pretty good job. About 30 to maybe 40% of patients will eventually come off surveillance for some abnormalities. But nevertheless, sometimes treatment can be deferred completely, and sometimes it can be deferred for many years. And I think that's preferable, to treat the people who need to be treated and watch the people who we can tolerate watching with.
So I'm going to have to jump to treatment before we get to genetics. So the treatment, there's like the pellets, there's drugs, there's surgery. None of these options are very, let's say, easy. And that's why surveillance is so important. Is that accurate?
It is. Now, we're evolving a little bit more. We're beginning to dip our toes in the water, if you will, on focal therapy, where instead of whole gland ablation, which we would do with seeds or external beam radiation or surgery, that we're using a more confined approach. It's sort of the lumpectomy, if you will, in the breast cancer nomenclature. So
a confined approach with like radiation and beads, or a confined approach with the scalpel?
Well, not the scalpel, but typically we've been doing it with either cryosurgery, or there are various ablative techniques that can be used, or seeding. So the idea is, when you limit the ablation of the gland, you also limit the side effects of therapy. When you ablate the whole gland, there are nerves that run in and around the prostate, and there's a urethra which runs right through the middle, and you end up with problems with either incontinence or erectile dysfunction, which are very common when associated with the traditional radiation surgery seeds. And here we're trying to get to a little bit better place for the patients. Now, not every patient is an appropriate candidate for that, but that's one of the things we're doing differently today. It's on protocol. We're treating patients on protocol with focal therapy.
Tell me a little bit about the genetics then. What have we learned about genetics?
Well, a lot of advances in the last couple of years, and we've learned, you know, certain genes, and I'll mention the BRCA genes, particularly BRCA1, BRCA2. And BRCA2 is the most important genetic driver of prostate cancer we've been able to characterize, but there are others as well. There are genes like ATM, PALB2, a variety of DNA repair genes. And those genes are very important to diagnose in families. They're all associated with prostate cancer, but in women, they're associated with breast and sometimes ovarian. So we believe that the addition of genetics into our sort of portfolio of options for the patients when they come in is important, not only for the patient, but also potentially for the family.
So the same genes that have to do with of familial breast cancer are the same genes that are involved in the prostate cancer?
Absolutely. So the BRCA genes, the BRCA, were originally described as breast cancer genes, but now we appreciate they put men with mutated at very high risk for prostate cancer as well. And by the way, there's ovarian cancer in women and also pancreatic in both sexes. So we now have a much better understanding of the genetics that are driving this disease, and some aspects that are relevant to breast cancer are also relevant to prostate.
So should I be tested to see if I am a carrier of the BRCA genes?
It really is dependent on your family history. There are criteria set up. So, you know, brothers, multiple brothers with prostate cancer, sisters with breast or ovarian or pancreatic cancer, a lineage, and there are guidelines that are set up and now endorsed by the NCCN, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, that would drive testing. And these are pretty well established now because there's been a lot of good scientific work on this topic.
So I'm not aware of a history of breast or prostate cancer in my family. But if there were, then that would lead my primary perhaps to do some genetic testing.
You know, the primaries are not quite well positioned in this yet because, you know, the science is always ahead of primary care. But I think if you ended up in a specialized center, that if you have the appropriate family history, we could test. And in that circumstance, we could put you under sort of a heightened surveillance, a heightened screening, if you will, because we know that people with these particular lesions are at very high risk for prostate cancer. And unfortunately, they're not just high risk for the good cancers, they're high risk for the bad cancers.
So I think what I'm hearing, because fortunately for me, I mean, my family has other diseases, but cancer is not a, a big powerful one as far as I know in my family. But if it were, how would I go about getting some surveillance in a, what type of, if I'm on Google, what should I search?
Yeah, so one of the things that is sort of an interesting rise in technology driven is some of the genetic companies are offering genetic counseling even before the testing can occur. So yes, there are specialized centers like Tulane, and Memorial Sloan Kettering does it. University of Washington, Seattle does it. University of California, San Francisco does it. Dana-Farber does it. But if you're not in a specialized center, there are companies, and I'll throw out a couple. One is called Invitae, I-N-V-I-T-A-E. I'm not endorsing them, but they do a good job. And Color Genomics, same thing. I'm not endorsing a company. Don't believe in that, but they do a good job. And they actually have the ability to access genetic counselors over the web, make an appointment, you sit at home, do a Zoom call, or have a correspondence. They can advise you on the pros and cons of testing, and there can be some cons. For instance, insurance is still potentially affected. Things like life insurance can be affected if you find out that you have a genetic abnormality. On the other hand, discrimination in health insurance is now illegal. So there are pros and cons of testing. And then if you do choose to have testing, that can be even be set up remotely.
In Alabama, there's a program where they will do genetic testing on you as part of just, you know, you just have to sign up for it. It's part of a study that Alabama is doing on Alabama genomics. And they just test you for just whatever in terms of almost a screening thing. I don't know if BRCA is on there. I don't even know, because it's been a couple of years since I did a doc talk on it, but people can sign up for that study through UAB, which, yeah, and they give you the data.
Well, that's good. You know, one of the things I want to tell patients is if you are going to sign up for a study, make sure you have access to the data. There's some studies that restrict the patient access to data, and I'm not very wild about that myself. So I don't think I would participate in a study in which the genetics would be analyzed, but I would not be informed.
Oh no, you're definitely given the data. So advances in the final thing you want to talk about was advances. So tell us about treatment advances.
Well, there are two recent FDA approvals, and both build on this genetic abnormality. So if you have a BRCA mutated, either germline or somatic, and somatic refers to the tumor itself having an abnormality, then there are now things called PARP inhibitors that can actually prolong survival. So if you were paying attention yesterday to the European Society of Medical Oncology, there was a big splashy presentation on overall survival benefit of PARP inhibitors for those with DNA repair alterations. And those are typically going to be BRCA1, BRCA2. The other ones are a little more suspect. But now there's FDA approvals, and that's important. We're also targeting prostate in new ways with PSMA-targeted therapy using radioligands. Not FDA approved yet, but my prediction is that'll be the next FDA approved therapy, probably coming in 2021.
You're going to have to back up a little bit for me. Did you say PARP inhibitors?
PARP inhibitors. So there are a variety.
Can you spell that?
Spell
that, please.
Sure. P-A-R-P.
PARP.
And that stands for polyadenosyl ribosyl polypolymerase. And it's part of the DNA repair pathways.
Okay.
And it turns out that if you have a DNA repair deficiency, such as BRCA, and then the cells can sort of manage to survive because other aspects of DNA repair are compensating, but But if you inhibit additionally the DNA repair using these PARP inhibitors, the cells with the mutations and the double mutations where it occurs within the cancer, the cells will literally collapse and die. And now we have evidence that the utilization of PARP inhibitors, there are two of them, olaparib and rucaparib, benefit patients very substantially when there's an underlying DNA repair defect, and their FDA approvals for these PARP inhibitors for patients with advanced prostate cancer, assuming that they have DNA repair defects, such as the BRCA mutations.
So you, as an oncologist, it seems like there has been a huge sort of sea change in what you can do in the last 10 years versus the previous 25 years, if you know what I'm saying.
I do, and I agree.
And is this due to advances in genetics? Is this from mapping the human genome? What has led to this robust change in treatment?
Well, there are a couple of elements, but mapping the genome was a huge advance, and then the ability to sequence on a routine basis. You know, it used to be if you're going to sequence the human genome, you better get ready to spend $1 billion. We can now sequence the genome, the entire genome, for under $1,000. That's a huge advance. And we can do these selected genes that are implicated in cancer genetics quite readily. And for instance, the color test cost about $249 if you want to pay cash for it. Well, to have a legitimate genetic screen for $249, that's a huge advance. Now the therapeutics are following that diagnostic advance by targeting specifically genes that can benefit from various drugs. And that's one of the reasons we've had so much advance in oncology as a whole, the ALK inhibitors. Or the one that led the way was in leukemia, and there's a drug called the imatinib that very specifically binds in CML to a kinase that is part of the translocation etiology of the cancer. When you inhibit that kinase, the disease goes away. And beforehand, we were using bone marrow transplants and high-dose chemotherapy. Now you just give a pill, and the cancer gets better. So a lot of these advances are due to the underlying biology that we understand better, the underlying genetics we understand better, and then targeted approaches that allow people to benefit. That's been a huge part of the advance.
Well, frankly, you've given, I think, our viewers a lot of hope when it comes to cancer. And it sounds like prostate cancer, with screening, active surveillance, and advances in treatment, is a very treatable disease.
We're doing better today than ever before. We still have people who die from prostate cancer. We still have imperfections, but we're way down the road compared to where we were one decade ago, two decades ago, or three decades ago when I started in the field. Completely different field today than when I started.
Oliver, I appreciate you pulling over and talking to us today. I think that this couldn't have gone any better as far as, you know, having a discussion. So I'm glad you were able to take the time and do that for us, and drive safe, okay?
Great. Thank you, Brad. I appreciate the opportunity to be with you.
Oh, that was awesome. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you. I don't know how to stop this. Hold on. Sorry. Oh, there it is. End. End meeting.